Muy buenos días. Vamos a dar inicio a la sesión del día de hoy. Tengo el gusto de presentarles al doctor Cristian Andrés, que el doctor Cristian Andrés es un invitado que viene de Estrasburgo, de Francia, de la Universidad de Tours. Él es médico con especialidad en neurología. Hizo sus estudios y su doctorado en biología celular y neuroquímica. Tiene un postdoctorado en la Universidad Hebrea de Jerusalén y se ha desempeñado como el jefe del Departamento de Bioquímica y Biología Molecular en el Centro Hospitalario Universitario de Tours desde el año de 2001 y actualmente es jefe de toda la unidad de estudios de imagen del cerebro que comprende este mismo Centro de Estudios de Neurobioquímica y Biología Molecular y de Imagen en el Cerebro, y que aparte tiene una unidad muy importante de investigación sobre el autismo en la Universidad de Tours, y que agradecemos también a la Embajada de Francia, que nos apoyó para hacer que estuviera con nosotros. El doctor Andrés tiene más de 200 publicaciones y ha sido una persona muy importante en el desarrollo y pionero en el desarrollo de la metabolómica del autismo y, un colaborador muy importante en nuestro grupo. Cristian.
Muchas gracias, Humberto. And buenos días, and unfortunately this will be the only words in Spanish that I will talk to you today, and I switch to English. So many thanks for inviting me, it's always a great pleasure. I was here 2 years and a half before, and I am happy now to show you some new results of our group and some improved concepts, I hope, about our studies in genetics of autism and in metabolomics of autism, which are the two main subjects of the talk of today. We have, in fact, two questions that we want to answer. The first is, of course, there is genetics in autism, but what are the models that we can think about? How can we think this genetics? So this will be the first part of my talk. And the second part, is that we need still today to improve the tools to make diagnosis of autism, to make it faster, to make it easier. And we have different ways to improve this, and I will show you one of these options, which I believe will be interesting, which is metabolomics, which is analysis of small molecules. I'll try to show you a little the progress that we did in this field. So, why genetics? Of course, you know all probably that there are several hints that genetics is important in autism. The two main are that there is a high recurrency in families in the first degrees, which is around 5%, and which means that you have a chance to be autistic in a family where is already an autistic person about 10 to 30 times more than in general population. So this is the first argument, and the second is the big difference between monozygotic and dizygotic twins. In monozygotic twins, you have a concordance approximately of 95%, and in dizygotic twins, you have the same concordance than in the first degree relatives, which is about 5%. So this big difference means that there is a big genetic background, important background in autism. So I will not go far in this field, and I go directly to the three models that we can think about genetics in autism: monogenic, digenic, and polygenic. So among these models, the most original is the digenic, and I try to convince you that perhaps it's the most frequent in autism that we could expect in the future. So monogenic is conceptually very simple, of course. One gene is mutated, and you have different sort of transmissions, recessive, dominant, or X-linked. And in our group, we have a speciality in families with X-linked mental deficiency and autism. And since approximately 35 years, Claude Morin, who is the geneticist of Tours, who is now retreated, has gathered a lot of families that we are still studying today. And this is very important to have clinicians who are exploring, in fact, a lot of families to get information about these families. So we need to keep in mind that if we want to validate a gene, we have two conditions. One is the segregation in the families, and this is not something else as the LOT score of Morton, which was described in 1955, and that people almost forget today to look after. And the second is that if you have one family, you should find other families to really validate this gene. And if you check on internet or on some databases, you will find that almost 600 or 700 genes have been studied and have been linked to autism. And unfortunately, among these 600 genes, a very few quantity has been validated. I think not more than 25 or 30 genes. So even if we have probably identified hundreds of genes which could be involved in autism, we still need to validate all these genes. And what I want to convince you today that it's possible to validate genes, but it's a very complex and rough work. So we have monogenic families where you have like this some boys which could look like an X-linked gene. And we know since 25 years that several known and very well-defined genetic diseases, monogenetic diseases, represent approximately 10% of autistic people. I just put here the most frequent of them: Fragile X, tuberous sclerosis, neurofibromatosis type 1, or Angelman syndrome. And the blue part means how many people, when they are mutated in these genes, have an autistic phenotype. So you see, in some of these diseases, like tuberous sclerosis or Angelman, you have almost half of the people who are autistic, but of course, not every child with this mutation is autistic. So it means that some other factors probably have a role, and that's what of one of the big questions, of course, that I try to convince you later, that perhaps there are other genes which are involved in these phenotypes. So we have described in 2004 a huge family that you can see here, where there is a mutation on the X chromosome, and the mutation is in a gene which is called neuroligin 4X, NLGN 4X gene. And in this family, we find either mental deficiency or autism, or the two together in the same person. And this was published in 2004. And we found particularly two autistic boys in the family, and they didn't have any mental deficiency, which is very interesting because it means that the same mutation can give a mental deficiency or autism and mental deficiency, because some other people had also little signs of autism. So this neuroligin 4 gene was also described by other groups, in particularly by Bourgeron in Paris. And the neuroligin protein, product of this gene, is a protein which links the presynaptic to the postsynaptic region, connected to a protein which is called neurexin. And this neuroligin is found either in excitatory synapses with glutamate as a neurotransmitter, which represent in our cortex about 90% of the synapses, which is very important. And if you listen to me today, it's because your glutamate is working. And then you have the inhibitory synapses with the GABA neurotransmitter, and this neuroligin is also present in these synapses, which means, in fact, that neuroligin is really spread all over the neurons of our brain. So, and you see a lot of proteins which are connected to this neuroligin, and you can see proteins which are also, which have also been described mutated in autism, like this Chang protein, which is now well known, and several other proteins in the post-synaptic region. And this is this group of protein in the pathway of the excitatory glutamatergic synapse. We have another family which is also X-linked, and you see this family is even huger, and the mutation is on a gene which is called UPF3B, and again we found in this family either autism or mental deficiency. And here we could validate several other families where there were also mutations in this UPF3B gene, which means that this gene is really involved in the disease, in the phenotype of these persons. But we don't know really how this gene is working to give the phenotype of autism. And we made some studies to show that the protein, which is here a transgenic protein, which is linked to the GFP gene, and which makes a green color if you put it in a fluorescent microscope. And you can see, interestingly, that the protein is expressed in the dendritic spines. And these dendritic spines are the postsynaptic regions of this glutamatergic neurotransmission. But we don't still know exactly what's the precise role of the protein. On the biochemical level, the protein is well known. It's involved in the nonsense-mediated messenger RNA decay, which means that if you have a mutation and you have a false stop codon, this protein will enable, by a complex which is linked to the exon junction regions, which will destroy the messenger RNA. So it means that all this mutated messenger RNA will go to the garbage, and it will protect the cell from producing false proteins. And of course the way is long from this biochemical function, which is very clear and very simple, to understand how this biochemical function can be involved in the brain. So we think the main function which are modified are the number of cells, the multiplication, and then neuronal maturation, which is a very large field, of course, and which needs now to be explored in, for example, in transgenic animal models. A third example of a big family is a family, again, X-linked, and where the mutation is in a gene which is called PTCHD1. And in this family, we found a truncation of the gene at position 143. And in this family, there were only two boys, which are one with autism, pure autism, without deficiency, again, and one with autism and with a small intellectual deficiency. And we could validate this mutation in other families due to a huge consortium, which was published just recently. And you see that most of the families have deletion of part of the region of this chromosomal region, and all this deletion encompass the gene, which is the little blue place here. You see all the deletion encompass the gene, and we have only three families where we have point mutations, and the family I showed you is this one. This is a truncating mutation, and the three families are truncating mutations, so we think these are loss of function mutations, and of course which will be expressed in boys which have only one X chromosome. So the mystery now is to understand what is the function of this gene, and it belongs to a family which is composed of four members, PCCH1 to 4, and these proteins are very similar to a 12 transmembrane protein which is called PTCH1, and this PTCH1 is in fact the receptor of sonic hedgehog. It's a patched receptor, which is the receptor of sonic hedgehog. And the ligand of this protein, of this PTCHD1, is not yet known. So, in fact, nothing is known about the function of this this protein today. The function of the homologous gene, PTCH1, is to be a transporter. This is a 12 transmembrane domain protein, and the molecule which is transported is not yet clear. Probably vitamin D3, in fact, or some cholesterol analogs. And the function of this transported molecule is to block a receptor which is called smoothened, and which is in fact a transmembrane protein which continues the signal to the nucleus. And if you add the ligand, which is a sonic hedgehog, you block the transporter and you free the signal. And this way is very well known in the neurodevelopment. So now the task is to find which is the ligand of our gene and which is the molecule which is transported. And some work is going on, but for the moment we don't have any answer about this. We have checked what was the effect of the truncating mutation of our mutation in our family, and putting again a GFP protein to follow the protein inside the neurons, we could show that if you make a truncation of the protein, there is a dislocalization of the protein. You see here the normal protein which is nicely localized in the dendritic spines, on this dendrite here, and on the whole soma of the neuron. And if you make a truncation, the protein stays inside the stomach around the nucleus and isn't transported on the dendrite. So we believe that this function is missing in these mutated boys, and there is some dysfunction on these dendritic spines. Excuse me. And the dendritic spines of these boys. So these were the three examples of monogenic diseases, X-linked. And now I want to go a little more in another model, which is the degenic heredity. Today, there are not too much diseases which are known to be degenic. There is a database on the internet that you can check, which is the list of all the known degenic diseases. It's called DIDA, I think. You can find it. And the model is very simple. Again, you have one of the parents has a mutation in one gene. This mutation is doesn't give a phenotype. The other parent has a mutation in another gene, a different gene, which can be on another chromosome. And if the child is sick, he inherited the two genes together. So it could be similar to a recessive disease, if you want, but on two different genes. Two different genes need to be mutated in this hypothesis. So now we go back to the neuroligin 4X family that I presented to you as a monogenic disease. And if you check carefully, there is a good, perfect segregation with the mutation, which is in red here, and with the disease. You have all the affected patients have the mutation in the gene and are all affected. This is the red circles. But if you go a little more in detail, you see that some of these patients are autistic, as I told you before, and some have a pure mental deficiency. But they have exactly the same mutation. So we wanted to see if there were other correlations with electrophysiological results. And we used a concept which is called mismatch negativity. So this concept is a sound that is 1,000 hertz, which is repeated, which makes like beep, 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 and then you put a deviant sound, which is a D, which makes beep, 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 like this. And people are watching TV without the sound, so they are not paying attention to these sounds. And you take the evoked potential with an EEG, with an electroencephalogram, and you make the subtraction of the evoked potential between the D and between the S sounds. And you get these waves. And you see that this wave is called the positive wave, and is the wave of the mismatch negativity. So in green, you see the mismatch negativity of the control, which is a huge wave. And in red, you see that the autism have a different wave. Autistic patients have a different wave. So these are means from several patients. And you see two things. First, the shape of the wave is different. It's much smaller. But a very important thing, you have here a wave which is much earlier. So the autistic patients detect this deviant sound very earlier than, which is important on an electrophysiological level, than the normal patients. And you can illustrate this much more clearly on a map, on a bidimensional map, which represents the top of the head. You have the nose here, back of the head here. And with these electrodes, you can draw a map which is the surface, the area of these waves. And you see in a normal person, you have one generator here, which is in the middle of the brain. And in the autistic patient, you have an atypical mismatch negativity wave, which is divided in two. And you have different activities here, and you cannot see it very clearly, but here you have a latency which is much shorter, which is 170 milliseconds, and here the latency is almost 200 milliseconds. So this difference is very important, and again you see here much clearly that the mismatch negativity profile is atypical in autistic persons. So what we did was to compare this autistic patient of the tree that you saw just before with a healthy parent which had no mutation, and you see as we saw before that here the autistic patient has an atypical profile, the control has a normal profile, and then we compared it to the mutated patients who were not autistic. So these six persons have the mutation of the neuroligin gene but are not autistic, they have only a mental deficiency. And you can see very clearly that this patient look much more similar to the normal one than to the autistic one. So the conclusion is that we have an endophenotype which corresponds to the autistic phenotype and not to the mutation. So this, of course, is a big question, because now we are almost believing that the autism phenotype is not depending on the neuroligin 4X gene mutation. So what is the explanation? Of course, it can be any explanation, environmental explanation, or even other mutation on other genes. And this was the hypothesis that we wanted to test. And to do this, we did exome sequencing of this affected autistic patient problem. And we compared with his uncle, who was mutated on the neuroligin 4X gene, but who was not affected by autistic disorder. And in subtracting all the mutation, we finally found, after a long work, and this is just a short summary, that this patient bared a mutation on another gene, which is called GLBRB gene, which is, in fact, the beta subunit of the glycine receptor. And he got this mutation from his mother, and this woman didn't bear this mutation, so we believe either it is a new mutation or it came from this grandfather that we didn't have the DNA to control. So in this case, we believe that the phenotype was correlated to this mutation in this gene. How can we explain the physiology now? In fact, the glycine receptor is colocalized with the GABA receptor on inhibitory synapses. And these inhibitory synapses are linked again by the neuroligin 4X gene. So we have here a two-hit hypothesis, where first you have a disruption of the correct connection between the two parts, and second, you need to add a second hit on another receptor, on another protein, to get, in this family, autism as a phenotype and not only mental deficiency. Fortunately, we could study another family with Neuroligin 4X gene, and again, we observed a second mutation in another gene. This is the second family. So, first, this family had this Neuroligin 4X gene mutation, and we found in this family a mutation in a protein which is in the postsynaptic density, which is called Ankyrin 3, and Ankyrin 3 is linked to the glutamate receptor, and this hypothesis then involves the excitatory synapse of this person. So in the two cases that we could make a whole genome, whole exome sequencing, we found second mutation which was clearly, which could be clearly explain the phenotype. And these mutations were already described in autistic patients, and we believe that if we would search in this person, we would find also a second mutation, probably. What is the physiology of this observation? We are clearly in a concept of perturbation of the inhibitory and excitatory synapses. And this is very interesting because the mismatch negativity is clearly depending on this excitatory and inhibitory balance between the two synapses. And probably in autism, we have here a hypersensitivity of this autism, of this mismatch negativity, which could correspond to some clinical observation like hypersensitivity to sounds that you can describe in autism, which could be linked to this mismatch negativity, which would be an endophenotype of this behavior. So the third model I wanted to illustrate is the polygenic model, which is even more complicated, of course, where several genes need to be modified in the same person. They can be on several chromosomes. And the big thing that we need to keep in mind is if we are in a polygenic model, each gene has a modest effect, which makes that we have we need to study a lot of patients to get some statistical results. We were focusing on a gene which is called RNF-135, which I will call RNF, which is just close to the neurofibromatosis 1 gene. So why did we study this gene? Because in neurofibromatosis 1, there are approximately 40% of patients which have learning difficulties, and the risk, the autism risk is increased in this disease. It believes approximately 1%, the slide I showed you just before, 1% of NF1 patients have autistic features. And second observation, which is genetic, is that in 5% of neurofibromatosis 1 patients, there is a huge deletion which encompasses the RNF-135 gene. The deletion is between repeats, which are here and here, in these gray zones, and you lost all this part of the 17th chromosome, and you see that the NF1 gene is a huge gene, and you lost also this RNF-135 gene. And why is it interesting? Because these patients have mostly problems in IQ. They have a lower IQ, and they have also behavioral problems. They are mainly ADHD patients when they have this peak loss. So these were really two arguments to study a little nearer this gene. And in fact, we sequenced the exonic portion of the gene, and we found three coding polymorphisms, which were rare, which were less than 1% in the general population, and we found an intronic polymorphism which didn't encode the protein. And you can see if you make an association study between this polymorphism and between the two populations, autistic and control, you see that one of these polymorphisms, the one with and position 115, is associated very significantly, and the odds ratio in autism is 5.2. And what's interesting is that you find only heterozygous persons in general population. And we found in the autistic group several homozygous mutations, which means that there is probably really a difference between these patients. And here is the genotypes before were the alleles. And what was interesting that this patient that we found in the in this autistic population with this KK mutation had an overgrowth. His size was almost 1.6 standard deviation higher, and mainly what was the main observation was his head circumference was very big. He had a plus almost 6 standard deviation of head. He had a megaloencephaly. And if you check in the literature, in fact, already an English group described one mutation and microdeletions in this region where the patient had also overgrowth and head circumference increase. So this is probably in relation with the function of this gene, which is involved in the ubiquitination of a protein which is called RIG1. And RIG1 is an inhibitor of cellular proliferation. And if you ubiquitinate RIG1, you decrease this function. And our hypothesis is that it's again a loss of function, and you don't inhibit RIG1, and you have less reduction of cellular proliferation, which means you have an increase in cellular proliferation. In autism, it was already described that approximately 20% of autistic patients have a head circumference which is increased. And it has also been described on a histological level that probably there are more neurons on the cortex of autistic people. The few cortexes which have been examined have all shown that there was an increase in the number of neurons in these brains. So this would be really a very important point. Here we are not speaking about synapses, we are speaking about the number of all the neurons of the cortex. And of course the number of neurons will also influence the quality and the number of synapses. So now one level more complexity, because I showed you different genes and I tried to show you that there are different concepts of genetic transmissions that we can keep in mind. But now, if we ask the question, are these genes specifically connected to one model or to the other model, or is one gene involved in only one unique genetic model, the answer is no. It's more complex. And here is an example, just to show you, and there are several examples. Just recently, a group made an analysis of the SNPs of the polymorphism of this PTCHD1 gene that I showed you just before on the X chromosome, which was in a monogenic disease, clearly. And these people saw that there was one polymorphism which was very strongly and very significantly associated with autism. And in this case, the polymorphism is in a intronic region, and nobody knows the function for the moment of this polymorphism. And it means clearly that this gene, even if it has not what I would call a strong mutation, even if there are such mutations like this one, which are polymorphism, it could be involved in the pathophysiology of autism, and it could be a risk factor of autism, which means that this gene is also involved in polygenic model in this case. So this makes a complex mixture, and mixture depending probably on the position of the mutation and of the nature of the mutation. So some mutation in some gene can be monogenic, and some mutation will be only risk factors, and this means that this mutation will be involved in a polygenic model, which makes it really complex. So now the second part of my talk will be more biochemical, and why did we want to study biochemistry in autism? Because we have still a big problem in genetics. You know that even if you do a whole genome sequencing, you will find mutation, clear mutation, only in half of the autistic persons, approximately. So we wanted to, we have developed some in vitro models, some animal models, and we try now to develop some markers which could be taken as a phenotype, new phenotypes, metabolites, and I will speak only on this chapter. So, why metabolites? It's well known since several years
that a huge series of metabolic diseases can be associated to autism. So this is just an excerpt of all these metabolic diseases. One of the most known is phenylketonuria, which is clearly linked to phenotypic aspect which resemble to autistic spectrum disorder. And some other diseases like Smith-Lemli-Opitz syndrome has also clearly a phenotype of ASD. So what we did was to take urine samples, which is relatively easy, not always in autistic person, but at least easier than to take blood. And we studied with an analytical method, which is called nuclear magnetic resonance spectroscopy. The big advantage of this method is that you don't need to treat the sample. You can just take it and put it in the machine and you get a result. It takes approximately 1 hour and then you get such a profile. And in such a profile, each peak represents a molecule, or sometimes two peaks represent the same molecule. And then you can have an idea on the identity of the molecule and on the concentration of the molecule in these urines. And after this, we make a statistical analysis, which is called OPLSDA, which is a multivariate type of multivariate analysis. And we try to find the projection using all these results to find the best projection to separate the controls, which are these black dots. Each dot represents a person, and the red dots, which are the autistic person. So you can see on this projection several things. First, you have some outsiders here. And if you analyze a little more carefully these outsiders, in fact, these are autistic persons which are treated with some drugs. So these were excluded in the next analysis. And then you can see that there is a very good separation between the two groups. You have only three autistic patients which are segregating with the controls. You have no control which is on the autistic side. And you can describe this by two numbers. This is a number which describes the quality of the projection, which is called R2Y, CUM. And this is a number which characterizes the predictability of the model. So there is a these are just mathematical models of this OPLSDA, but I will show you that these numbers are very important. Of course, everybody wants to have 1.00 at this place. This is the target. So if you check now what are the molecules which enable this separation between autistic patients and between the controls, you see that two of these molecules are very significant if you do a mono a univariate comparison. You have succinate and you have glutamate. And I will speak about these two molecules a little later. These are really the important molecules which enable the separation. So we tried to improve this analysis in taking a second spectroscopy, which is called a bidimensional spectroscopy, using this time carbon added to the hydrogen. And these results are not peaks, but these are little dots. And you have, of course, much more information when you take such an analysis. It's also a little longer. It takes 1.5 hours, approximately. And you see again that you get a nice separation, but you see again some patients are on the wrong side on this separation. If you remember, this number is much better now. We go from 0.5 to 0.7, and this is a little lower. So it's not perfect, but it improves. And if finally you combine these two methods, and then you have approximately something like 50 information, 50 items that you use, 50 molecules, and you have now a really very nice separation, and all of our parameters are much better now. And this is always using this spectroscopy. Now, is this a robust result? Was it replicated? And the answer is yes, because an English group made the same analysis in the same time we did ours. And you find again that they found an increase in succinate, and they found also a decrease in glutamate, like we did. And this means that probably these results are reproducible in different populations of different countries with different methods and with different researchers, which is very interesting. So now we did the last study that we just published in December, which was to answer the question, If we analyze much more metabolites, do we improve the model? It's not obvious that it improves. We know that in the urines there are probably something like 5,000 metabolites, different metabolites. What's important to know is among these 5,000 metabolites, most of these metabolites come from the food and come from the bacteria of our gut. And we have only a small part of this which comes from our own metabolism. So it means also that when we analyze such urine, we analyze mostly the environment of the people and we analyze their gut bacteria, in fact. So with this method, we can now analyze on one side the spectroscopy, the same that I showed you just before, and on the other side we use several techniques of mass spectroscopy with different subgroups. I don't go into details, but four different types of mass spectroscopy, and then we pull all this data together to make what is called the data fusion and to analyze together something which is equivalent to 500 to 700 metabolites. So if you do this, the only thing to see in this table is that the two parameters that we were speaking about are approximately the same that I showed you before. But if you put a combined model, the block model, you see that a huge improvement. You go almost to 0.9 for the R2 and to 0.75 for the Q2, which means that we get here a huge improvement for separating the autistic population from the control population. And then what we did was to take a new group of patients that were not used to build this model, this mathematical model, and to check if this new group was again correctly predicted. And the result is here. You have a sensitivity of 100%, which means we identified all the autistic patients, but we have a low specificity. That means that we identified also control patients as autistic. So this model is not yet perfect, and you can make another representation which is called a rock curve, that what we use in general in the hospitals to see the quality of a biomarker. And if you show this to a biologist in a hospital, he will tell you that it's not so bad because the area of this curve is higher than 0.9. That means that we make an error less than 10%. In fact. And you can see also the same OPLSD representation that I showed you before. You see that here the two groups, and this is not the training group, that means it's not the group which helped to build the mathematical model. This is the group of a new persons that were not used to make the mathematical model. It's the validation group. So this is very important to see that the validation group is really very nicely separated between the autistic and the control patients. So these are the very last results, which open, of course, a lot of new studies that we are now going to do. Just to speak about succinate, the people who were here 2 years ago probably remember that I spoke already about succinate, because we have, in general, in all these studies, the most significant metabolite is succinate. So what is the important point in succinate? If you remember a little your biochemistry, succinate is an intermediate molecule in the Krebs cycle, in the three carboxylic acids, in degradation and formation of energy from glucose. And if you make a zoom on this Krebs cycle, succinate is here. And what is very interesting is that the molecule which is just before succinate is alpha-ketoglutarate. And if you go to another cycle which is connected to this Krebs cycle, you discover glutamate and you discover GABA. So glutamate is an excitatory neurotransmitter in the brain, and GABA is an inhibitory transmitter in the brain. And you see that these four molecules are deeply connected to the Krebs cycle through this alpha-ketoglutarate and this succinate. So if you check now, there is one reaction which makes the glutamate to ketoglutarate. So this means that in one step, you go from this excitatory amino acid to a molecule which is involved in energy. And it's the same for the GABA. Only you have two steps. From GABA, you can go to succinate by two steps through two enzymes, and one of these enzymes is very really interesting. It's succinate semialdehyde dehydrogenase, and this succinate semialdehyde dehydrogenase has been involved in autism. I will just show you. So the enzyme which makes the GABA is called glutamate decarboxylase. And this enzyme has already been studied in autism, and it has been shown that it's reduced in autistic brain. It has been done on brains of autistic patients, and this is a publication of 2002. And there is also another hypothesis that you find sometimes autoantibodies in autistic persons, and the epitope against they are directed has been described as this enzyme, this glutamate decarboxylase, which is a sensitizing enzyme of GABA. On the other side, there have been description of deletion or mutation in this gene, which is the semialdehyde dehydrogenase, which is a protein which enables transformation from GABA to succinate, which is blocking here. So it means you cannot destroy the GABA. And in this disease, which is a rare disease, but you have one third of the person which have an autistic phenotype. So this points really very strongly to these two molecules, which are succinate and glutamate in this excitatory and inhibitory synapses. We come back again to these synapses that I showed you before with the huge monogenic families. So we need now to, of course, to validate this data in other population with another ethnicity, with other environmental situations, and with other food. And for example, we would like to do this in the Mexican population, because here you have really very different environmental and ethnical backgrounds. We have already begun a study in Lebanon, where it's also a very different situation, and we try to compare the three population, if we can get this of Mexico too, and we will really be very excited if we find the same molecules in the three population. Of course, we need to go far, more far, to see the specificity of the molecules, and we need to see some groups of mental deficiency patients, and we have now a study that will begin on trisomy 21 to see if there is some correlation between mental deficiency and this molecule, and how we can distinguish a mentally deficient patient from an autistic patient in studying the urines. And of course, the most obvious question now is what is the correlation between these dysregulated pathways, biochemical pathway, and the mutation that we described before. So this is the most difficult point of the story, because as you could see before, even if you have huge families, you have only one or three patients that we know in these families. And this is, of course, not enough to make any statistics about metabolites. If you have an analysis of 500 metabolites, you need a huge amount of patients to have some statistical significance. So this is the most exciting part of the study, but the most difficult, and we are not even beginning this part now today. We are trying to find more mutated patients to put them together to make these studies. So let me conclude in thanking my colleagues. So these are the persons involved in the genetic studies. This is the psychiatric team, and this is the biochemical and molecular genetic team. And these are the persons involved in metabolomics. These are the main actors, which are mainly biochemists and physics professor. And again, our pedopsychiatric professor, which is Frédéric Bonnet-Brieux. I thank you for your attention, and I answer your questions.